Okay, so what I want to talk about now for the next few lectures is the case of the affine algebras, okay, and trying to do the same sorts of path models or crystals, root operators, things like that in that setting. Okay. And we'll sort of, you know, largely work with examples. So, but before that, let me start out by recalling some of the relevant, you know, things from what Venkatesh has been talking about last week. So, well, affine B algebras, and the one that we really care about for now is what usually called SL2 hat, or is the Lie algebra of type A11. And this is really the following thing. So let's recall, you start out, you construct this in a couple of steps. So first there is SL2 itself, or SL2C. This is just the set of all, you know, 2×2 matrices. Okay, maybe we'll just say A11, A12. Aij is complex and trace 0, and this is a Lie bracket, I mean the, it's a Lie algebra under the usual Lie bracket, AB minus BA. Now this is SL2C. Now we form what's called the loop algebra of this. So this is sometimes denoted SL2 of TT inverse, or SL2 of CTT inverse. What this means is just you take all 2×2 matrices, but now allow your entries to come from this ring, CTT inverse. So this is now a set of all 2×2 matrices. Again, the same conditions, except that each entry is a polynomial in T and T inverse. So now the sum of these two polynomials is identically 0. So Laurent polynomials. So this is sometimes called the loop algebra of SL2. So it's called L of SL2. It's this. And so this is the first step. This itself is a Lie algebra under, it's a Lie algebra over the complex numbers. It's a vector space over C. And the Lie bracket is still the same, defined the same way, AB minus BA. But this isn't quite what we want when we want to construct this. So what we do is we construct a central extension of this, right? So this is sort of the first approximation. Then there is, once you have this Lie algebra, so I should say this is a Lie algebra under this bracket. If I have two matrices A and B depending on T, then you still do the same thing. Multiply and subtract in two different orders. So then step two is the central extension. Of the loop algebra. Okay, so what this means is it's the following two things. Number one, you add in an extra element which will be central, which will commute with all elements of L of SL2. So this is the new guy. So let's call this SL2 tilde, which is the loop algebra of SL2 together with an additional element. Do you call it C or K? C. Okay. So it's direct sum CC. C is now the central element, one extra additional dimension, and satisfying the following property that C is central. So now this is a new vector space with a new Lie bracket, so with Lie bracket. So the first property is that C should commute with everything. So C commutes with X for all X coming from the loop algebra. Okay, so that's the easy relation. Now, the central extension process essentially does the following. It modifies the Lie bracket for two elements which come from L of SL2, right? So the new Lie bracket is the following. Suppose I have two elements of SL2, of the loop algebra of SL2. So given two elements A and B in the loop algebra of SL2, we now define a new Lie bracket, meaning this is the Lie bracket in this Lie algebra SL2 tilde. So what we do is we keep the old Lie bracket. We compute their Lie bracket thought of as elements of L of SL2. That is, just take these two matrices and do AB minus BA. But then this is only one portion of the answer. So then there is plus some multiple of C. Okay, so this is the modification. You say every pair AB, two elements of SL, I mean, you think of them as elements of SL2 from the loop algebra of SL2. Their Lie bracket in SL2 hat is the old Lie bracket, when you think of them as elements of SL2, plus some additional deformation, some extra term, which is a multiple of C. Okay, and this extra term is what Venkatesh called that's the 2 cocycle. And to describe this, it's easier to take matrices A and B, which are sort of simpler, rather than writing this out in complete generality. So if you have two elements, so how do you compute this additional term? So this is the 2 cocycle. And this extra term is computed as follows. So for example, if I have, say, instead of A and B, so maybe here A and B are elements of SL2. So maybe I'll just use X and Y instead. T to the KX, T to the LY. So to say what this is, let's take K and L, some integers, X and Y, now elements from SL2C, not the loop algebra. So when I say T to the KX, I just mean you multiply all four elements of this matrix by T power K. Right? So that's an element of the loop algebra. T power LY again is an element of the loop algebra. Now their Lie bracket computed in this larger Lie algebra is just T to the K plus L times, let me write this, XY minus YX. So this is again an element of SL2C multiplied by some power of T. So this is now an element of the loop algebra. This is a loop algebra portion. And then the central extension, the cocycle. So this is now, if K and L are negatives of each other, only then do you get some non-zero contribution. So it's delta K minus L. So K and minus L must be equal, in which case the contribution is K times the trace of XY. Right? So this is the formula for the 2 cocycle. C, thanks. So that's the multiple of C that you get. Right? So to recall, this is how the central extension is carried out. So first you have a loop algebra, then you have the central extension. And then one observes that the new object we have constructed at this point, SL2 hat, has a natural grading. It comes with a grading, which means you can write it as a direct sum of subspaces indexed by Z. Okay? And the grading here is just, so how would you write the grading? SL2 tilde is just direct sum of, let me say, SL2 tilde kth graded space, k running over z, where the kth graded space is just the obvious one, SL2 tilde k. It's just everything in which the power of t in front is t power k. So this is basically just all things of the form t power k multiplying elements of SL2C. Okay. I mean, it's just an informal way of saying it. You take elements of SL2C and you multiply them by t power k, sort of like what we did here. So this is a typical element of the kth graded space. Okay? So all four entries are multiplied by t power k times complex numbers. So those are the kth graded spaces. And the zeroth graded space, similarly, would just be SL2C by this token if I put k equal to 0. But then since there's also a central element, I also add in the central element there. So this is if k is not 0, and the zeroth graded space SL2 tilde 0 is defined to be, just take the usual SL2C, but you also throw in the central element there. Okay, so that's the, that would be your zeroth graded space. Fine, right? Now, with respect to this, one checks that it is a graded Lie algebra, which means if you take something from the kth graded piece and something from the lth graded piece, the answer lies in the k plus lth graded space. Okay, so notice that that's true here. If I take something from the k and l, I will get an answer which lies in the k plus lth graded space, space always. I mean, except maybe you may object that there is this additional term which arises now and then, right? So should we not worry about this? If I take something from the kth space here and something from the lth space, the Lie bracket lies in k plus l modulo some error term. Right. So this error term only appears when k plus l is 0, right? That's exactly what this term here says. So this will only arise if k plus l is 0, in which case this is only a multiple of c, and c is expressly thrown into the zeroth graded space. Okay. So notice that the error term is also fine because of the way it arises, only comes up in that specific context. Okay. So this is in fact a graded Lie algebra so far, SL2 tilde. And when you have a graded Lie algebra, there is a grading operator. Okay. So what is meant by the grading operator? You just define an operator D on your Lie algebra, which just gives you the grade of an element. Okay. So there is a grading operator, and that's this additional derivation that you throw in. So what does this grading operator mean? So you just say, so what is the grading of an element? So this just does the following. So this is the additional derivation. So this is D acting on X. Sorry, maybe I shouldn't call it X anymore. D acting on A will just give you the grade of A, K times A, whenever A belongs to the kth grade piece. Okay, so this is the grading operator D. There always is an additional operator that you can define. Okay, so I mean, I'm just defining what Venkatesh did. You throw in an extra derivation. I mean, if you just wanted to define the grading operator, it's defined like this. On the kth graded piece, it acts as k times identity. Okay, so whenever you have a graded space, you can define a grading operator. On the different graded spaces, it will just act by the corresponding eigenvalue. Now what you do is you throw in an additional operator such that add of that operator acts like the grading operator. Okay, so that's really your additional derivation. Okay, so this completes the entire construction of SL2 hat. So recall finally that SL2 hat then was defined to be this SL2 tilde with this additional guy, with an additional grading operator. Or in terms of the loop algebra, you first construct the loop algebra of SL2C, centrally extend it to get this graded algebra, and then throw in its grading operator, and all told you get SL2 hat. Fine? So this was the definition of SL2 hat. So the first thing is, it's actually an infinite dimensional Lie algebra. So we think of it as a Lie algebra over the complex numbers, and it's an infinite dimensional Lie algebra. The key reason we want to study this is that even though it's infinite dimensional, much of its structure theory and representation theory is akin to what we have seen for the finite dimensional simple Lie algebras. Okay, so this is a lot like just the usual SL2C, for example, or the usual SL3C. Or SL4C. So SL3 is probably a very close analogy to this. But in general, the theory is a lot like that of the finite dimensional simple Lie algebras. Okay, in what sense? So let's list out all the parallels. So again, to recall what Venkatesh has done so far. So the first thing is the presence of a root space decomposition. Okay, so I have this this algebra. So I can write it as H. So SL2 hat is, there is a Cartan subalgebra H, and then direct sum of eigenspaces of the Cartan, eigenspaces right. This is what root space decomposition always means. You need first find a Cartan subalgebra, and then the rest of the algebra decomposes a direct sum of eigenspaces for the action of that particular subalgebra. So in this case, the Cartan is just H hat turns out to be just the Cartan of SL2. So this is, so maybe let's write the usual SL2. Recall, can be thought of as, so there's a Cartan subalgebra H, then there is an X and a Y, or an E and F, depending on, so maybe I'll call it E and F. So what are these elements? H is just, so this is H, the diagonal, E is the upper triangular matrix, and F is lower triangular. Okay, so that's the decomposition of the usual SL2C. That's the root space decomposition, if you wish. And now here, the Cartan subalgebra is this. It's going to involve the Cartan of the finite guy and the additional two elements that we defined, which is C and D. So now first thing here is, recall, this has the finite Cartan and then the two additional elements we have added. Okay, so let's just draw the picture. It's useful to draw the picture of the root space decomposition. So one of the standard ways of drawing this is to say, I have, first I draw the picture of SL2C. So this is H, this is F, Z. Imagine those are the three elements, those three root spaces. Now all the other elements are as follows. So in addition to H, I have these two additional guys. We'll see about them later. But I can now just consider the other elements which come from the loop algebra, which is, for example, T times E. So the things on, so the first level here is all elements which are obtained as T. So the thing on top is T square, and so on. Okay, and similarly, this is T inverse. Etc. Okay, so we just imagine these lines running through. So that's a picture of just the loop algebra so far. Okay, I've just drawn all the T tensor. So when I say TE, this is what Venkatesh wrote as T tensor E, for example. I mean, it's easiest to just think of it as TE, which means this is like the matrix, for example, 0, T, 0, 0. Right? So I said you can think of SL2, the loop algebra, as just being 2 cross 2 matrices in which you plug in just the 4 entries are just elements from CTT inverse. Okay, and so on. So this is the picture of just the loop algebra. And these two additional dimensions, C and D, are bunched together with H. So I think of this C and D as being my Cartan subalgebra. This is my H. Right? Okay, and now what is the root space decomposition? Well, what we have here is already the root space decomposition. It turns out that each of these guys here, each of these dots on this picture, corresponds to an eigenspace for the action of add H. Okay, so let's see what those eigenvalues would be. So maybe we should start with just the H's. So let's take this middle string here. So H hat itself is let's not worry about it. That's just the Kartan. So I look at everything other than that. So let's look at things along this line. So let's look at TH, T square H, and so on. So if I take the vector T power KH, for example, okay, or maybe just let's start with TH. So the question is, what is the eigenvalue that corresponds to this? So when an element of H at, so observation number one, TH is an eigenvector for the action of the Kartan H hat with what eigenvalue? So let's compute the eigenvalue. So now observe the Kartan is three-dimensional, so I have to figure out how each of them acts. So I must ask, what is H acting on it? What's C acting on it? What's D acting on it? Okay, so and what's the vector I'm looking at? I'm looking at this. Right? So in order to find out what the eigenvalues, I need to figure out how each element of the Kartan acts on that. I'll get three eigenvalues in some sense, or I think of the eigenvalue as a linear functional. So let's compute the bracket using the Lie bracket I wrote out. So H with TH, according to that property, was, so this is like T power 0 H and T power 1 H. So this is just T power 0 plus 1 bracket of H with itself, which is just a zero, and I don't get a central extension term because zero and one are not negatives of each other. C commutes with everybody. D acts as the grading operator. Okay, so when D acts on something, it picks out the grade. So when it acts on T power one times H, I'll just get one. So it's one times T power one H. Right? So that's the action on TH. Or more generally, if I put T power K here, for any K other than 0, I don't want T to the 0, of course, because that H is already part of the Kartan. So let's do T power KH, K not 0. This is an eigenvector. And what's the corresponding eigenvalue? These two are still 0. This becomes a K. Right? So this is just the functional 0, 0, k in some sense. The eigenvalues are 0, 0, and k. Okay? So that's one. So we figured out the eigenvalue corresponding to this middle string. Now, so this eigenvalue for k equals 1 is what Venkatesh called delta. So let's define delta. It's an element. It's a linear functional on H defined by the following properties. H and C both go to 0, D goes to 1. Okay, so here's a linear functional. And this linear functional, if you notice, is exactly the eigenvalue for the eigenspace TH. Okay, so now we can answer this question. T to the KH is an eigenvector for add H with eigenvalue K times delta. Okay, so that's the root that corresponds to it because of this k in front, 0, 0, and k. So that's k times this linear function. Okay, now let's compute the eigenvalues in the other two bits. Again, sort of what Venkatesh has already done. Now, if I take t to the ke, for example, try doing the same thing. I need to see what is H, C, D. Again, by the same logic, D is just K times. C is always 0. And H is just going to give me 2 T to the K times bracket of H with E. So, and now here, of course, I will take all k. So, this is for k in z. Okay. So, I have to do bracket of h with e which if you compute is 2 times E. Okay. And plus I should get in, you know, I would possibly get an additional error term here, which is, which will kick in only if k is 0, delta k 0, k times whatever it is, some trace of something. Correct? That's the formula. But observe that k is 0 here. I mean, for it to kick in, right? For this to be a non-zero value, k has to be 0, but then this k will kill that term in you. So I don't need to worry about this term even in this case. Okay? So what I have is, in this case, 2t to the k e. So the eigenvalue here is a 2. It just gives me 2 times t to the k e, 0 k. Okay? And so this is now what functional does this correspond to? So we will have, so let's define what we call alpha 1 or alpha. This is again a linear function on h, defined by the requirement that h, c, d, so this is 2, 0, 0. This is like the linear, this is like the root of the underlying finite guy. And now if you define alpha 1 in this manner, then observe that this t power k e for k in z is an eigenvector for add h with eigenvalue alpha 1 plus k delta. Okay, so the alpha 1 is 2, 0, 0. The k delta is 0, 0, k. Okay, so that's the eigenvalue. And similarly, if you compute it for t to the k f, you will just get minus alpha 1 plus k delta. Okay, so similarly, so I'll just leave this computation. T power k f corresponds to minus alpha 1 plus k delta. Okay, so what that means is, you know, we have computed the root space decomposition. So we know what the roots themselves are. They are minus plus or minus alpha 1 plus k delta, k running over z. And these guys, which is just k delta, but now k not allowed to be 0. Okay. They are, oh, thank you. Thank you, indeed. Absolutely. They are in h hat star. Okay? So let's collect these roots together. So that's just like in the finite dimensional case, we'll call it delta for the set of all roots. So this is all k deltas, k not 0, and alpha 1 plus k delta, k in z. Minus alpha 1 plus k delta k in z. Okay? And like I said, the root spaces are also written out. We know which root space corresponds to which of the roots. Okay, so this is just recap of the structure theory of SL2 hat. So in this sense, it's going to be like the finite dimensional case, that we have a nice root space decomposition. And observe here that all the root spaces are one-dimensional. But in general, I mean, this is something that happens in SL2 hat. In general, it won't be the case. When you go to other SLN hats, the guys in the middle will usually have higher dimension. Okay. Okay. So now the next thing is the representation theory. So which again is going to be very, very analogous to the finite dimensional case, except we will restrict ourselves to a study of representations where we can carry over, you know, much of the same theory. So I mean, there is some restriction. We are going to restrict ourselves to a class of irreducible representations, additional adjective here is integrable highest weight representations. of SL2 hat. So that's the category of representations we are going to look at. Okay, I mean, irreducible, integrable highest weight already means irreducible, but I'll just throw in that adjective here. So this is, well, it's again given by, it's parameterized by dominant weights. So this is again what we have in the finite dimensional case, that the irreducible finite dimensional representations of SL2 are parameterized by dominant weights. Here the irreducible integrable representations, which may in general be infinite dimensional, these are parameterized by the dominant weights. Okay? And this, the for a given lambda in P plus, the corresponding representation, so sometimes we would call it V lambda, but it's in this case, we usually call it L lambda. You called it L lambda, right? You called it V lambda? OK, let's call it V lambda. What? Oh, here. Ah, OK, fine. Let me do that. So P hat plus will just mean the space of dominant weights of dominant integral weights for the affine case. OK, so let's define P hat plus. So so dominant integral in this context will mean all linear functionals whose values lambda on, well, what was it in the earlier case? So we said on sort of the simple root. So this is how we had defined z greater than or equal to 0, right? So recalling how we did it in the finite dimensional case, lambda of alpha check is a non-negative integer for all I going from 1 to L for all the simple roots of the algebra. So here again, it's the same thing. So for all I running over the simple roots, or for all alpha I check running over the core roots, but here there are just two of them. There are two simple roots, and they are labeled by conventionally I equals 0 and 1. And these two simple roots in the case of SL2 hat are the simple core roots. So we need to say what the simple roots and core roots are. So let's start with the simple roots, or maybe coroots since they appear here. So there's going to be alpha 0 check and alpha 1 check. So alpha 1 check is just the coroot for the underlying SL2, the finite dimensional algebra, which is H itself. And the simple roots on the other side. So corresponding to this, the simple root is what we have now called alpha 1 there, whose value on H is 2 and the value on the other guys is 0. So that's the usual alpha 1. Now alpha 0 is what we need to pay a little bit more attention to. So in this case, it turns out to be, it's defined like this. It's C minus H. Okay. So observe the simple coroots were always elements of the Cartan, even in the finite dimensional case. The Cartan here has two more dimensions, C and D. And this now involves the additional dimension. This guy is just H. This fellow is minus H plus a C, okay, the other dimension. And alpha naught, in this case, similarly, turns out to be delta minus alpha 1. Okay, these are now elements of H star. Okay, I mean, that's a close parallel. This is minus H plus C. That's minus alpha 1 plus delta. Okay, so this is how these are defined, the simple roots and coroots for this affine case. And granting these definitions, it's easy to work out what P hat plus must look like. So what must it do? It must, you know, on H, it must have a positive value. That's lambda of H must be a non-negative integer. And then lambda of C minus lambda of H must be a non-negative integer. Okay, so those are the two conditions in some sense. Okay, so that's what P hat plus means in this case. Now, so let's look at the representations. So what, I mean, let's look for some examples here of elements of P hat plus. So example, because the easiest is to just take lambda equal to 0, which is the representation corresponding to just the weight 0, which is dominant by definition. And this just corresponds in some sense to the trivial representation. So what is V of 0? This is just the one-dimensional trivial representation. Okay, so that's the case of the trivial representation. Now, in fact, there are other examples of dominant weights. So for example, you could take lambda to be delta. So if you look at the element delta that we defined, the definition of delta was that it was 0. So what was delta really? Delta was its values on H, C, and D. Only D had a non-zero value. This is what delta was, right? Only on D it's 1, the other two it's 0. So by the same token, see this P hat plus here now only requires you to know the values on H and C. Those two values are only involved here. So here the value on both H and C is 0, therefore on H and C minus H is 0. Okay. So in some sense, this again is 0. Even though this is delta is a non-zero element of H hat star, the relevant part of it is really like 0, because on alpha not check and alpha 1 check, it still is 0. So it turns out that this is really, again, a one-dimensional representation. So this is almost like a trivial representation. So this is still a one-dimensional, you know, almost trivial representation, if you wish. So this is a one-dimensional representation of SL2 hat. The point is that the element D acts as identity on it. Okay, that's the difference. Here, the element D will act as identity on this one-dimensional representation, whereas here it acts as 0. Okay, but other than D, the rest of the fellows all act trivially. Okay, so that's the only difference here. Okay, now the other, these are all instances of dominant integral or dominant weights. So the key remark here again is, unlike in the case of the finite dimensional Lie algebras, this is not really a lattice. So observe that lambda of alpha I check is an integer. It's only being imposed. There are only two conditions you're imposing. Okay, but this is actually, this lives in three-dimensional space. Right? So this is actually set of all solutions in three-dimensional space for these two integrality conditions. Okay, so what you get is not a lattice. It's not a discrete set. It's actually a continuous set here in this case. Okay, but it doesn't really matter. So for example, instead of delta, I can take any complex multiple of delta. That will still do the same job. That any complex multiple of delta is still considered an dominant integral weight in this case. Okay, but it's sort of a, you know, it's only a minor point. It's not a rather deep fact here that, you know, it just leads to representations which are almost like these. So we don't particularly care. Okay, the other important thing here is, what about the adjoint representation? So that's an important example of a representation in the finite dimensional cases, right? Lie algebra acting on itself. So it's natural to wonder what happens here if you take this Lie algebra SL2 hat and consider its adjoint representation. Okay. The meaning of integrable, yeah, sure. So integrable means the following, that if you take these simple, these two simple, not the coroutes themselves, but the simple root spaces. So integrable means the following. Consider the elements simple root spaces, if you wish, or the Chevalier generators. You call it the Chevalier generators, right? Okay, or the Chevalier generators. Okay, which in this case, let me just tell you what they are in this case. So we look at this E, this element E that we talked about, and this element TF. These are the two generators. So in the picture, they appear, so if you remember those three lines, this is the horizontal E appears here, and TF appears here. So these two guys are the Chevalier generators in this case. And their negatives, right? So I should also look at the other two guys and the negative root spaces, as well as F and, sorry, this is T inverse E. So I should look at these four guys, E, F, T, F, and T inverse E. So these four elements, these special elements of the Lie algebra, should act locally nilpotently on the vector space. So these guys act. So local nilpotence means they act nilpotently on any given vector, but the index of nilpotence can change with the vector. Right? A higher power may be required if you change the vector. But some finite power will kill any vector. Okay, so that's the definition of integrability in this case. So this is, if you want to think about it, it's the analog of finite dimensionality. That it's a weight module. Yes, you're right. So there is an additional condition as well, which is that the H hat should act diagonalizably. So I should have a weight space decomposition. That's another requirement of integrality. Thank you. So it is a weight module, which means H hat acts diagonalizably, and further there is local nilpotence for the actions of these four guys. In the finite dimensional case, this is, I mean, if your Lie algebra is finite dimensional, this property is really like finite dimensionality. It's sort of equivalent to finite dimensionality in some sense. Okay? Now, sorry, what was I saying? Adjoint representation. So the adjoint representation, you can define it in this case, but it turns out to be integrable. That's, you know, if you just follow the definition, it turns out to be an integrable representation. This is very much integrable. In that these four elements will act locally nilpotently. The adjoint action will be locally nilpotent. But it's not of the kind we are interested in, the sense that this is not even a highest weight representation. Okay, so here we are actually only looking at highest weight representations. So this guy, for example, is not highest weight. And it's not irreducible as well. Okay. Why not? Because the center is an ideal. So observe, irreducibility for the adjoint action, I mean, what is an invariant subspace for the adjoint action? It is just an ideal, right? And here the center is in fact an ideal. There is a non-trivial ideal here. So it's not going to be irreducible even. Okay. So that's not of the kind that we want. So the thing that we will be most interested in is what's called the basic representation, so what Venkatesh has talked about at length. So this is, so let me again recall the main facts about this representation. Okay, so we'll only look at what's called V of lambda naught. So this guy is called the basic representation. Of, in fact, any of the affines, you have an analogous definition. So this is what we look at as the basic representation of SL2 hat. So that just is defined by knowing what lambda naught is, what is the dominant integral weight here. So H, C, and D. So it's defined by these. So lambda naught is 1 on C and it's 0 on the other two guys. Okay, so this particular element is what we look at. So there's also an analog. So observe, this just means that lambda naught on alpha naught check and lambda naught on alpha 1 check, in, written in terms of the coroutes, alpha 1 check is the same as H, so that's 0. And alpha naught check is C minus H. So the value on that is 1 minus 0, which is 1. Okay, so you should think of this notation. Lambda naught comes from this. It's a fundamental weight with respect to these two coroutes. It corresponds to the fundamental weight for the coroute 0, meaning it is 1 on that guy and 0 on the other coroute. Okay, so analogously, we have the opposite guy as well. We have lambda 1, which is the other coroot. So it is, you can look at the other fundamental weight, which is 1 on this and 0 on that. This would be the other guy, and that again you can work out what it does to this. So lambda 1 is defined as follows: CHHCD. So on H it is now 1, okay, and on C it's also 1. Only then would C minus H give you 0. So it's 1, 1, 0. That's the weight lambda. So this guy will also be important. But in some sense, turns out that they are both, I mean, there's a symmetry which relates these two. So it's more or less enough to understand what lambda naught is, or the representation lambda naught is. Okay? So that's the representation we're going to look at. So first, we will try to understand the weights of this, or I'll recall what Venkatesh has told you about the weights of this representation. So, step one, since lambda naught is a weight, that's the highest weight of the representation, all elements in the while orbit of lambda naught are also weights of this representation. So that's the first step. One tries to understand what the while orbit looks like. So to say what the while orbit is, so of course we need to understand what the while group is in this case. So, do you call it W or W hat? W hat is now the while group of the affine algebra. So I need to understand what this, what W hat is for a start. So again, to recall how the while group was defined in the finite dimensional case, it's the same definition. I have two guys, alpha naught and alpha 1, and therefore I have two reflections, S naught and S 1. They are now reflections, meaning they are some linear operators on H hat star. Okay, and again, let's recall what these were. S naught acting on lambda by definition is lambda minus lambda alpha naught check alpha naught. S1 similarly is lambda minus lambda alpha 1 check alpha 1. So that's the definition of the reflections. Okay, and in this case, it turns out that, you know, one can profitably understand this by looking at the product of these two guys. So S naught S1, so this product, S naught S1 of lambda, so which is what's called the translation operator. So this is called this T alpha 1, defined to be the product S naught S1, is just, so if you write out what this does in full, this is just lambda minus, can never remember this. So this does the following. It's lambda plus lambda of C alpha 1 minus lambda C plus lambda alpha 1 check times delta. Okay, so this is what it does to a lambda. And this operator is called the translation T alpha 1 of lambda. Okay, and Venkatesh sort of explained why it's called the translation by passing to sort of the underlying finite dimensional space. You can view it as just like an affine translation and so on. But let's not worry about that. This is some operator T alpha 1, which is just the product S naught S1, and that's the formula for, you know, if you actually work out what it does by unraveling all the definitions. Right? I've told you what this is, and so on. So it's just a question of unraveling the definitions, and you write it out, this is what you get. And what's interesting about this is that when you raise this to the power n, so if you look at what is T alpha 1 power n, so that is like S naught S1 power n. And turns out, so where do the n's fit in? It's like lambda plus lambda Cn alpha 1. So I get lambda Cn alpha 1 minus, so this term again becomes an n. So as an n here, n times, but this scales as n square. Okay, so if you sort of raise this to the power n, it's almost the same formula, except the alpha 1 scales as n, the alpha 1 check scales as n, but this additional term here with the lambda c, that gets an additional n square term. And so Venkatesh gave you the more general formula for the translation by any alpha. This is, you should think of this as just the norm of n alpha 1. So this translation to the power n is like just the translation by the element n alpha 1. So you can sort of see the n alpha 1 here, and the n alpha 1 check here, and the n square is like the norm square of that. So that's sort of the general theory. But again, you know, I'm not going to use any of that. So sort of important to know what this formula is. We'll specialize it to the case of lambda naught, where all this is much simpler. Okay? So don't worry if you haven't entirely understood the whole structure of the affine wild group and so on. Okay. And the key point about the affine wild group is really this, that you can view it as T semi-direct product, the finite wild group. So what is T and what's W? W is just the finite wild group, which means it's just 1 and S1. It's a subgroup generated by S1, which only has two elements here, 1 and S1, because S1 square is identity. And T is just this, all these guys put together. T alpha 1 power n, also called T n alpha 1. Okay, S0, S1 power n, you just take all those powers. So those guys put together, so this is nothing but S0, S1 power n. Okay, so this is a structure of the affine wild group. So in particular, if you sort of see what this means, T consists of all elements which are of the form S0, S1 power n, which means things when you write it in terms of S0s and S1s, it has an even number of terms. So that's what T comprises. And W has either 1 or S1. So, you know, when you take the element 1 from W, the corresponding thing you get is even length words. And when you take S1, you will get all the odd length words. Okay? In other words, if you really think of what this means, this says that the elements of W hat look like this, either S0, S1 power n, or they look like S0, S1 power n with an additional S1 at the end. Okay, and I should let n range over all integers. Right? Just physically what the elements look like. Okay? Not worrying too much about semi-direct product and so on. Now this, what is this? This is, if n is positive, this is like S0, S1, S0, S1, ending at S1. Okay, that's for n greater than or equal to 0. If n is negative, it's just the inverse. And since they're involutions, it's like writing it in the reverse order. This is for n negative. Okay. Now, when I act an additional S1 at the end, what does it do? If n is positive, it'll knock off this S1 from the end. Right? So it'll leave me with a term with an odd number of elements. Or if n is negative, then this is what I get here, and I need to add an additional S1 at the end. Okay. So that's just a string which starts at S1 and ends at S1. If you knock off the S1, it's a string which starts at S0 and ends at S0. So these are the four types of elements that you can get. We start at S0, end at S0. So it's an odd length. Start at S1, end at S1. So these are both odd length words. These are even length words. Fine, and every element of the wild group is in one of these four kinds. Okay, so that's sort of the thing it says. It's an infinite dihedral group in this case. So this is like an infinite dihedral group. So this is isomorphic to an infinite dihedral group. In other words, there are two generators, S0 and S1, and the only only relations you impose are that S0 squared is identity and S1 squared is identity. Okay, it's sort of the free group generated by these two guys, subject only to the relations that the squares are identity. So that's the structure of the group. And the other important thing here to note is that the other very important fact about the while group itself. So this is the structure of the while group. So I've just told you about how the while group acts. We eventually want to understand how it acts on lambda naught. But before that, we'll just record this observation that it's very easy to see what it does to delta. Okay, and the reason being proof, if you look at S0 and S1, well, both of them fix delta because the additional terms are just zero in both cases. So by definition, delta is zero on both these terms. Right? Just look back on the definition of delta. It's only one on D and zero on H and C, which means these are zeros. Okay, so the two generators fix delta, so everybody else fixes delta. Fine? Okay, so that's an important fact. So now let's get back to W lambda naught. So what is a typical element of W hat? So I need to now compute. So observe W hat of lambda naught is therefore, let me think of it like this. It's translations by N alpha. Did I say what the translations do to lambda naught? Okay, maybe I'll do that now. So let me look at translations by N alpha 1. So these are the elements. W hat looks like either translations or translations times S1. So this is now as N varies over Z. And now I act this on lambda naught and observe that both terms really act the same way. So observe S1 fixes lambda naught. So this term S1 will leave lambda naught fixed. Therefore, whether I compute Tn alpha 1 or Tn alpha 1 S1, the answer is really the same. So it's enough to just understand how these translations act on it. Okay? So the while orbit of lambda naught is therefore just the same as the T orbit of lambda naught, just the translations themselves. And the translations actually act in a very simple manner. So I sort of wrote that formula out here. Right? I told you how Tn alpha 1 or T alpha 1 power n, what does it do to a lambda? This is what it does. But now let's specialize to lambda naught, okay, where things become even simpler. Because this term will now vanish. Lambda naught on alpha 1 check is 0. Okay, we just used it. Lambda naught on alpha 1 check is a 0. So if you sort of unravel the definition there, how does the translation Tn alpha 1 act on lambda naught? Let's be lambda naught plus n alpha 1 minus n square delta. Okay. Lambda naught of C is 1. We also use that. Okay. So this is something that Venkatesh has probably talked about already. Okay. So this is the key thing, that translations act in this very simple manner on lambda naught. There is one linear term and a square term. Okay. The coefficient of alpha 1 is linear. The coefficient of delta is square. So let's draw the diagram. So we understand now the while orbit of lambda naught. So here's the figure which we'll sort of use. So this is just, imagine this is the axis delta axis and the alpha 1 axis. Now this formula there is just a formula for a parabola. Okay. So what I'm saying is that the while orbit of lambda naught I will imagine as follows. So forget the lambda naught portion for now. So let's just plot n alpha 1 minus n square delta on this thing. Okay? So I have to let n vary over all the integers. So now if n is 0, this is just 0, the origin. So if n is 1, so I have 1 and the delta coefficient is 1. So it lies on this parabola, y equals minus x square. So I have this, let's plot it here. So this is n equals 1, so that is alpha 1 minus delta. So this is 0. Then I have this thing at the other, minus alpha 1 plus delta. Then when I put n equals 2, it's 2 alpha 1 plus 4 delta or minus 4 delta. Again, the other side. And so on. So let's just plot one more on both sides. Did I say plus again? Thank you. So 3 alpha 1 minus 9 delta, and this guy should be minus 3 alpha 1 minus 9 delta. Okay, and so on, right? So this is the, I've just plotted, you know, I've forgotten the lambda naught coefficient. If you wish, the correct way to think about it is to translate this to the lambda naught plane, right? I have the third dimension lambda naught, so I just move everything to the lambda naught plane. So imagine then that this origin is shifted to lambda naught. So this is really lambda naught. This is lambda naught plus whatever, and so on. That's maybe the right way to think about it. So it's a parabola in that plane. This you mean? Sorry.
Alpha 1 plus delta should be
minus
alpha 1 minus.
Ah. Thanks. Rest are okay? Yeah, seems fine. Okay, so that's that's a picture of the while orbit, if you wish, of lambda naught. And what is it that we need to know? What's the rest? What do the rest of the weights look like? Okay. Yes. You mean why did I draw delta up and alpha 1 to the right? Yeah. Just a random choice. Yes, absolutely. Thanks. That's a good question. So he's worried about why I pointed delta perpendicular to alpha 1, for example. Right? So in some sense, so if you recall in SL3, you know, we sort of drew things at certain angles, right? 60, 120, and so on. And there's good reason for doing it because there's an inner product on the space with respect to which you can actually think of it as, you know, those angles as a positive definite form and so on. Here we don't quite have that. It's only a semi-definite form. So I've just done it for convenience if you wish. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, any other questions? Okay, now what about the rest of the weights? We have only worked out the, we have only worked out so far the wild conjugates. Now, it turns out that the rest of the weights, as Venkatesh told you, are as follows. They are just these guys and the delta strings through them. Okay? So to complete the picture of this representation, what you have is the following thing. It's a notion of a delta string, which is when you have a weight. So whatever it is, there's just imagine all other guys of the form lambda minus delta, minus 2 delta, minus 3 delta, and so on. So weights of this kind, this is called the delta string through lambda. So this is the delta string through the weight lambda. Okay, so it starts at lambda and goes down. So imagine a string of weights like this. That's a delta string. Now, the full picture of weights of this representation L lambda naught is just the following. It's these guys along with their delta strings. Okay, so through each of these guys, I just need to draw a vertical line, delta string through this, delta string through this, and so on. Okay, so there's already a line through this. And, you know, on each of them, I'll just mark lambda naught minus delta, minus 2 delta, minus 3 delta. Similarly here, this minus delta, and so on. Okay, so I just have to do it to each of the delta strings, that's it. Okay. So this is, I'll just write a couple of them, lambda naught minus delta, lambda naught minus 2 delta, etc. Fine, so that's the picture of the weights. That's the entire weight diagram of L lambda naught. So L lambda naught, the set of weights of L lambda naught are just W lambda naught and delta strings through them. So I should say is nothing but the union of delta strings through, I mean, W is the same as T in this case, through each element of the while orbit of lambda naught. Okay, so that's a complete list, but I'm sorry, what? Thank you. L is the same as V, absolutely. Okay. And this, of course, is only the picture of the weights themselves. The weight multiplicities are what you need to complete the picture. So the weight multiplicities in this case happen to be given by the partition function. Okay, so the values of the partition function. So in this case, you know, what are the weight multiplicities along the delta strings? It's sort of enough to really understand the delta string through lambda naught. In some sense, that's really the only guy you want to understand, because all the other fellows are just wild conjugates of that delta string itself. In other words, if I take lambda naught minus delta, for example, and I act some wild group element on it, what I will get is W lambda naught minus W delta, but W delta is delta, remember. So this is just W lambda naught minus a delta, that's it. So if lambda naught goes to this guy, then the delta string through lambda naught will map, you know, each correspondingly to the corresponding elements of this delta string. So the whole string itself maps to that string. Okay? So therefore, in some sense, it's enough to understand the weight multiplicities along one string, because weight multiplicities are invariant under wild group action. If you know all these multiplicities, you can work out the multiplicities of any other one from that. Okay, so in this case, it turns out that the weight multiplicities are given exactly by the values of the partition function. Okay, so the weight multiplicities, in other words, what's the dimension of lambda naught minus some k delta? The answer is it's just p of k, where p of k is just the number of partitions, the number of integer partitions, if you wish, of k. Okay, you did this,
yeah.
Right? Okay, so this is the key statement. P of k now is just the number of partitions, meaning you try to count how many ways there are of writing k as a sum of other non-negative integers. So this is pk, therefore all the other guys is the same. So this dimension is also therefore the dimension of v lambda naught, any other w lambda naught minus k, for all w in the while group or in T or whatever. Okay, so this picture together with this fact sort of tells you everything you need to know about the representation. I know all the weights and I know all the multiplicities. It's the same thing. See, W of lambda naught minus k delta is the same as W lambda naught minus k delta, because W leaves delta invariant. This is what you mean? Yes. So it's the same thing, whether I do it this way or that. Okay. So like I said, this is the you know, in some sense, you know everything about the representation from this. So let's use this to find some sort of one. Which one? The fact that it is a number of partitions, you mean? Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's what this course is all about at some level, right? Yes, indeed. So we will prove this using, for example, LS parts. That's going to be one of my goals. Okay. Now, let's try to, just to get our hands dirty with this a little bit. I said we know now everything about the representation. Okay. Now, let's use the information we know to sort of patch these different delta strings together. Let's find out how they fit together. Yes. Yes.
One.
Yeah. It is, you can in principle compute these from, for example, the while character formula and so on. I mean, there is an in principle computation. If you, I mean, very explicit formulas are harder in higher levels. Right, not as easy as this, absolutely, yeah. They are much, much harder, yes. I mean, they are not very tractable in some sense. But in principle, if you want, it's all there, if you wish. Or LS paths, if you wish. Okay. So let's do the following. I want to figure out how these things, how these delta strings fit together. Okay, what I mean by that is the following. So let me define what I'll call the depth gradation. Let's try to understand this this vector space graded in a certain manner. Okay, so I'll call this the depth gradation. So it's sometimes called the, I mean, it's usually called the principal gradation. Okay, but what it is really the following. Okay, so what do I mean by this? I'm going to now stratify this into levels. Okay, so I'm going to define a notion of a depth as follows. So what is the depth of some element? So if I have, so let mu be a weight. Of this representation. So whenever I have a weight of this representation, that weight always has the following form. It should look like lambda naught minus something, minus, well, what? Minus a linear combination of the two simple roots. Okay, this is what it means for it to be highest weight representation. All weights are lower than the highest weight. In the sense that that minus some positive or non-negative linear combination of the simple roots will give me the weight mu. Okay, so to sort of define the depth of mu, I use these coefficients as a proxy for the depth. So how deep is mu relative to lambda naught? Well, it's just measured by c naught plus c1. So here's my definition. Okay. It tells me how deep I am in the representation. Okay. So C0 plus C1 is the definition of the depth of a weight. Now this depth gives me the following grading on this space, V lambda naught. I can now organize it by depth, meaning I take V lambda naught K, or maybe we should call it D, V lambda naught D, D greater than or equal to 0. What's V lambda naught D? It's just all those weight spaces is just the, I collect together all the V lambda naught mu's where mu has depth D. Is this fine? So I've taken all the weight spaces of my representation, which means this picture here, along with the multiplicities. Now, you know, imagine the, this is, for example, a two-dimensional weight space. Okay, so I take each guy of a given depth and I collect them all together. Definition okay? Fine. So let's try to understand what depth is in this case. So in this picture, what's the depth of lambda naught itself? The weight lambda naught has depth 0, right? Because lambda naught minus lambda naught, I need to figure out what is that. So this guy has depth 0. Now let's look at lambda naught plus alpha 1 minus delta. So delta, by the way, in this case is, if you remember what delta is, so this, okay, so maybe since we haven't been using alpha naught as much, but we really are working with alpha 1 and delta, it's also useful to have another expression for the depth in terms of, writing this in terms of, delta, for example. So observe alpha naught was just this. This is how I defined alpha naught. It's delta minus alpha 1. Right? So this is the definition of alpha naught. So writing mu in this manner, you can also write, if you want to write it in terms of deltas, it's the following. Lambda naught minus mu is therefore, or let me say mu can also be written as lambda naught minus of, I'll replace alpha naught by this. So it's minus C naught delta minus C1 minus C naught alpha 1. Is that right? I'm just changing basis, that's all. Instead of alpha 1 and alpha naught, I want delta and alpha 1. So I replaced alpha naught here by delta minus alpha 1. So I should have gotten a plus C naught alpha 1, that's this. Okay. So I can also write mu in this manner. So if you call these two coefficients as your I mean, you can always do this, but yeah, okay. Let me just say what's easiest. Anytime you see a delta, delta has, it accounts for depth 2. That's probably the easiest way to say it. Delta is alpha 1 plus alpha naught. Okay, so anytime I go down by a delta, for example, lambda naught minus delta, that weight appears in this list, right? What's the depth of this weight? Let's start there. Lambda naught minus delta. Delta is alpha naught plus alpha 1. So it occurs for depth 2. It accounts for depth 2. Right? That's the easiest. So this guy has depth 2. Lambda naught minus 2 delta has depth 4 and so on. So 2, 4, 6, 8, that's this delta string. Okay. Now what about these? So I need to figure out these fellows. Alpha 1 minus delta. So I have plus alpha 1. It's actually depth minus 1 because I need to go down from alpha 1. This guy goes up from alpha 1. So this plus alpha 1 will account for depth minus 1, but then this minus delta will account for depth 2. So it's 2 minus 1, which is 1. So this guy is actually at depth 1. And once I know that, all the other guys are just, I add 2 to them. Right? So these guys all occur at depths 1, 3, 5, 7. These depths are, this is minus 2 plus 8, right? So what's that? 6. What's this now? Minus 3 plus 18. So this fellow occurs at depth 15. Okay. Now this guy is minus alpha 1 minus delta. That's 3. Minus 2 minus 8, 10. Right? So those are the values. Okay, right. So let's look at the parabola now. Those are the wild conjugates. So what numbers are those? Triangular numbers, right? So those are in fact the triangular numbers, 1, 3, 6, 10, 15, 21, and so on. Okay? And for each triangular number, the delta string is just that plus 2s. Okay? Just keep adding 2s to this. Okay. So now here's the question. So now this is what I meant by wanting to find out how these all fit together. What are the dimensions? So I want to understand the depth gradation, right? In other words, how many things lie at depth 1? How many things lie at depth 2? What's the total dimension which lies at depth 3, 4, 5, and so on? Okay. So let me now ask, let me look at this depth gradation, V lambda naught D, and ask, how do the dimensions change as I change D? Okay, so let's just compute it. Okay, let's do it for the first few values. What's the total dimension at depth 0? So if D and this total dimension. So at depth 0, there's only dimension 1. Which is just the dimension of this weight space. So at depth 1, I have only one weight space, and these outer guys all have multiplicity 1. So remember, I should also keep taking each weight space with its corresponding multiplicity, because I'm trying to count the total dimension of the weight space. So this guy is 1, right? So that's just one contribution. So depth 2 is just this guy. Right? So that's again a 1 because, I mean, this is not on the parabola, but this is, if you remember that thing I erased, it's number of partitions of 1. Right? Along a delta string, the multiplicities vary as the partition function. So this is the number of partitions of 1 in this case, which is 1. Okay, depth 3, 2, because there is one contribution from here and another contribution from this weight space, which is also dimension 1. Both these are dimension 1s. So that's 2, 4. So there's 2 because this lies on this delta string and this is number of partitions of 2. Any others? Five. This is 2, right? Again on this delta string. Any others? This would have given me a 1 because this is the number of partitions of 1. Is this okay? I mean, I sort of erased it right when I needed it. So this delta string, typical delta string is number of partitions of 0. So this is lambda, lambda minus delta. Uska dimension is p1, p2, and so on. So this is 2, etc. Okay? So this was 3, is it? Okay, 6. So there's 1 here and number of partitions of 3. Correct? Is it okay? So that's 4. Okay? Right, that's P3, right? P3 plus 1. Right? And so on. So you can already see it's going to get going to become somewhat complicated as you go down the list. But the key thing to remember this, it's triangular numbers and then the even numbers, the plus 2s spawned by them. Okay, now here's the interesting fact. Anyone recognize these numbers? Okay, so here's fact. These numbers are actually V lambda naught, depth D is nothing but the number of partitions of D into odd parts. Okay, what does that mean? What is partitions of a number into odd parts? For example, if you take the number 6, all parts must be odd. Those are the number of partitions of 6 into odd parts. Okay, there are only 4 of them because all the others will have at least one even part. Okay. And of course, there's this famous theorem of Euler which says that this is also the number of partitions of D into distinct parts, which means you're only allowed to use 2 different parts. These are the partitions of 6 into distinct parts. Okay, there are 4 of them. And the theorem which says that, so by the way, this 6 doesn't count here. So these are the 4 partitions into odd parts, those are the 4 partitions into distinct parts. Yeah. No, not really. The dots on the parabola contribute 1, but then each parabola spawns this delta string, right? Along the delta string, the dimensions keep increasing. So how do they increase? By that diagram. Is the partition function. This is the point on the parabola, let's say. Then after that, this is P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, and so on. So according to the values of the partition function. So the deeper you go along a delta string, the larger your values will be.
When we are making this table,
yes.
Is it like the dimension? Or?
Yes, it is the dimension. Which means that's why I counted it with multiplicity. So if you see, for 6 and so on, so I said, this weight space, whose dimension is actually 3 because it lives on this delta string, plus this contribution, which is 1 because it lies on the parabola. So I counted them as 3 plus 1, 4. Absolutely. So you must take the entire dimension into account. Is it clear what I did, by the way? So I mean, this delta string, unfortunately, each dot seems to contribute 1. So it's not quite that. This is 1. This is 2. So I should have probably used Venkatesh's convention. So this is 3 and so on. So this is 1, 2, 3, and then the next guy is 5, 7, etc. So it's according to the values of the partition function. Okay? Is this fine? So now, so you see, it's already a slightly complicated picture because they all lie on the parabola, but then the depths and so on, everything matches up nicely. Finally, when you count how many live at a given depth, the answer is something simple. Okay, it's the number of partitions of D into odd parts. Okay, and so you know, we have just seen this by example right now, but in some sense, so maybe we'll prove this as part of one of the tutorial exercises. So I mean, there are sort of two ways to prove it. We will eventually prove this you know, differently, just using LS paths, you know, tomorrow. But the way this is usually proved, many of these things, is by using generating functions. Okay, so you actually do the following. You form a generating function. You don't study them individually for each D. So you do the following. You write out a formal power series like this, okay, and you study the entire power series in one go. Okay, now if you see what we have said about the structure of these depths, what we have said really is the following. On the one hand, there is the guys on the parabola, and the ones on the parabola really contribute triangular numbers. Okay, so think of this as follows. On the one hand, I have some triangular numbers. Okay, those are those 0, 1, 3, 6, 10, etc. And then, in addition to that, I have the partition function, some sense. Okay, so it's this. And the generating function for the partition function is, so, I mean, really it's, so if you see what this power series is on this side, it's just this. I mean, this is what it means to say, you know, what we are computing. On the one hand, the parabola, and then for each point of the parabola, there is this partition function. So that's encapsulated by this little identity here. The numerator tells you the powers which are contributed by the parabola points, which are the triangular numbers, and the denominator is what gives you the partition function. Okay, and so to prove that this is the same as the number of partitions of D into odd parts, what you have to prove is the following, that this simplifies. So here's how one could prove this. You show that this infinite sum divided by this infinite product, this simplifies to just a product of 1 over 1 minus q power k, where k only runs over the odd numbers. So instead of running over all integers, you can prove that you will only get the odd numbers when you simplify this. Okay, and so we'll do this part of the tutorial. You've already seen what you need to prove this as part of Venkatesh's lectures. It's called the Jacobi triple product identity. Okay, so there's a way of writing these sorts of sums as products. If you see, that's sort of what you need, right? This is already a product. The final answer needs to be a product. What you need somehow is to show that the numerator is a product which will cancel off all the even terms, leaving you only with the odd ones. So you need a way to express the numerator as a product, and that's given by this Jacobi triple product identity. So what you have to do is just plug into that and see that this guy exactly gives you the product over all the even numbers. Okay? So that's one way of proving it. So this is sort of the generating function way of proving many of these identities. But what we want to do, and what we will do tomorrow, is to prove this by LS paths. Okay, so where do LS paths come into play? How do we get LS paths out of all this? So let me just end by saying that recall, what are we trying to compute? Trying to compute dimensions of certain weight spaces, right? See, at the end of the day, all we are doing in this calculation is trying to find out what is the dimension of V lambda naught mu, where mu varies over all guys of depth D. So in some sense, this is the quantity that goes into the computation, right? And what's the path model really? At the end of the day, the path model, if you recall my very first lecture, I said you can think of it as a way of giving, I mean, it gives you a combinatorial description for exactly this number, the dimension of V lambda naught mu. So this can be computed as the number of, for example, Lakshmibai Seshadri paths of class lambda naught, the highest guy of weight mu, for example, of endpoint mu. Okay, so we will now use this point of view next time to actually prove this fact that you will just get the number of partitions of D into odds or number of partitions of D into distinct, you know, without using any of this, just purely combinatorial. Just compute, just describe the set and show that that set is exactly the number of partitions of D into odd parts. Okay, stop here.